Tiny showed up first. She showed up early. It ended up being Jermaine didn't like it because she wasn't supposed to sing. And so she got there early. So she goes, can I try it? I go,
I can't do this.
I guess. Crazy. You know, so she goes on the mic. And I thought she sounded really innocent. I said, wow, her voice was small. And something was very believable about it that I ended up liking. And I didn't think I was going to like it. And the other girls showed up and they were kind of like, you know, a little salty that she, because she doesn't normally sing lead, as you know. And then Jermaine called me, what's Tiny doing singing? Tiny don't sing. I go, well, she kind of did.
We sound crazy.
We do a thing here called your Mount Rushmore.
Yeah.
Right? I would love to hear two from you. So top four of two different subjects. Your Mount Rushmore of songwriters.
Mm-hmm.
And your Mount Rushmore of singers.
That's pretty good. Never thought about that.
Top four singers in your personal opinion.
Top four singers.
And songwriters, yes.
I mean, of course, Aretha and Whitney are there, definitely, as far as singers. Mm. For me, if it's me, you know, I have to put Marvin Gaye there just because it was such a huge influence. For me, I guess my Mount Rushmore would end with Maurice White.
Ooh.
Because he was such a big musical influence early in my life, or as that musician.
Yes. Yeah.
I wanted to write songs, but when I ran across an Earth, Wind, and Fire album and I learned what he was doing with all those people, I was like, how is he orchestrating all these people, writing the songs, producing it, and then later they would perform incredibly. So he was, as a musician and wanting to play, he was a major, I thought he was just a genius.
He was just a genius.
What he created, just the greatest band ever. It's not even close. Producers?
Yeah, producer, songwriter.
Producer, songwriter. You know, Kenny's number one for me, of course. My Mount Rushmore would probably be Kenny, Leon Silvers, Curtis Mayfield, who never got his just due, because that guy was incredible.
Yes.
And probably my last one, producer, songwriter. That's a tough one. It could go several ways with people. There was a guy named Norman Whitfield.
Norman Whitfield. But then,
you know, you still got Tom Bell and Linda Creed. Mm-hmm. You got Gamble and Huff. There's so many great.
It gets murky.
There's
a lot of good people.
I extend my Mount Rushmore.
Yeah.
But I tend to, you know, praise the people that, and probably because I'm a behind the scenes guy, and people say, hey, you don't get your just due. So I can relate to people.
Do you feel like that? Do you feel like you don't get your just due?
No, not me personally. People tell me that.
Yeah.
Okay. But I'm okay with it because I never wanted to be an artist.
Right. Yeah.
You know, I was always a kind of a shy behind the scenes person.
So the name Silent Partner, that's
came literal. From that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It was literal. I mean, we went to an event and people would see my name, but never see my face. They knew who Ellie and Kenny were.
Yeah.
And so we go there and this guy goes, who are you? I said, I'm Daryl Simmons. You're D. Simmons.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, you're the silent partner.
Yeah.
And I go, we thought you were a ghostwriter. I go, no, I'm real.
Yeah.
And so that's why I called it a silent partner. And I was always very comfortable with that.
But I
lean towards people like Leon Silvers, who did so much great work with the Whispers and his own group, the Silvers, and you know, Shalimar, all those great, the production and I'm telling this dude is incredible.
Yeah.
You know, and then Curtis Mayfield, because Curtis Mayfield, people don't realize Curtis Mayfield was writing music following Dr. King's movement.
I didn't know that either.
But it was subliminally. If you listen to it. If you listen to his songs.
That's crazy.
That he was following without saying it.
People get ready.
People get ready. Yeah. You know, we're a winner.
Yeah.
You know, all that. He was following Dr. King with music subliminally.
Wow.
And I figured that out on my own over years. And I got to work with Curtis. because he was living in Atlanta. Mm-hmm. And he wanted to work with me, but then he had had the accident. He was paralyzed.
Yeah.
And we wrote a song. I forget, I don't know the name of the album. It wasn't a hit, but I enjoyed sitting with him and once again hearing his stories. And
I'm a master.
Yeah, he just, and you know, if you think about Superfly, the soundtrack, that to me is, like, Purple Rain is really good, but Superfly?
Yeah.
I mean, that's my Mount Rushmore of soundtrack.
Soundtrack.
Because I know Jimmy Jam says Purple Rain, and it is great. Purple Rain's on there for me, but Superfly
is your number one?
Number one. Then I'd probably go Purple Rain, then I'd probably go Shaft. And after that, I'd probably go Boomerang.
I bet you better throw Boomerang in
there. Then I'd probably go Boomerang.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's just guys creating music without the technology and without auto-tune and just the rawness of and the pureness of playing the instruments and then singing. And there's something about that. Like you said, it's just, it's so emotional to me. Just old music is, it's just, I love it. It's just,
I love it. You mentioned Whitney on your...
let's talk about Whitney, shall we?
On your Mount Rushmore. What do you remember about that first session with Whitney?
First session for me was on the Bodyguard soundtrack, Queen of the Night. But I had been around Whitney because she was in Atlanta, but I never worked with Whitney.
Gotcha.
You know, people don't know, but I didn't work on I'm Your Baby Tonight.
Mm.
They did that without me.
Okay. Were there quick detour? Were there reasons why you worked on some things and not others? Or just
no,
just...
it's still a mystery. Some things because people don't know. I didn't have a contract with Elliot and Kenny.
Mm.
It was just we're cool. We grew up together. We're good, and I was good. Trust me, I was really good. Yeah. You know, I made a lot of money, wrote a lot of songs, but there wasn't a contract that said I had to do. Whatever.
Okay.
So
you got called sometimes, sometimes you didn't get called.
I got called most of the time.
Okay.
Probably 99 or 98% of the time. I can remember that time that I didn't get called. And, but then I didn't think I would get called for Michael Jackson, and I did.
Okay.
So it was kind of like,
right.
I would have thought that one I wouldn't have worked on. Mm. Anyway, so, you know, Whitney was around. I was around Whitney, but I hadn't worked with her. And my only time would have been Queen of the Night for the soundtrack, for the Bodyguard soundtrack.
He won a Grammy for that, too.
It was, I can't remember.
Yeah, he did.
What else? 40 million.
He's like, yeah, you won one. You won.
But that was fun. She was a lot of fun, a lot of energy.
Yeah, she liked
She actually
energy.
Pulled that song together because I don't know about you guys, but we don't write from titles.
Mm-hmm.
And Kevin Costner said, I want a song called Queen of the Night.
Oh, that's hard.
It was like,
yeah.
Dude. You know, the music dictate,
and then
say, okay, what is it saying?
Mm-hmm.
And so it was like pulling teeth. It was just like, how do you craft a song called Queen of the Night? And it was sort of, he wanted this sort of rock thing for the scene in the movie because she was a rock star.
Mm-hmm.
And it was probably one of the hardest songs to put together that I remember, I would say, for me in my career, one of the hardest, because it was writing from a title.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, instead of writing from somewhere else, yeah.
And she wrote it with us, and I really feel like she pulled that together. And at the end of the day, it did. It came out really, really, really good. But I think she had a lot to do with that, just kind of being there and her energy and, you know, her and Kenny vibing and, you know, Kenny orchestrating. Like he said, no, it's got to be rock. It's like we can't sing the backgrounds. I think he brought this white guy in to sing some on the backgrounds of everything that I want, got the thing that I need. And I think with her and him, that was a good combination that made it, you know, kind
edgy.
Of edgy, you know, gave it that edge that he wanted. But she was, what I remember, she was just more fun than anything. Just being around the house or going around the Pebbles house or being at the studio with her and Bobby wrestling. Yeah, me and Bobby, we was wrestling. Mm. Yeah, he thought he could take me, but yeah, he can't take me. He can't take me. And I'm just like, okay. So you're just bumbling up there, they wrestling and being Bonnie and Clyde, and, you know, but just a fun person. The first thing she goes, how them babies doing? How them babies doing? She would always ask about my kids. How them babies doing? That's the first thing she would say. I remember she would always say that. First thing I remember, how them babies doing? They doing good. They doing good. It's a lot of fun. A lot of fun. Great person to be around, and you know, it hurts. You know, when you think about it. And I wish I could have worked with her more, but I was around her more than I worked with her,
yeah,
you know, which was, it was cool, like I said, to know her. That was cool.
Wow.
Yeah. We sound crazy.
Yeah. SWV, you are my love. We had SWV on the show recently.
Yeah, I saw that clip. Yeah. Somebody sent it to me.
So, okay, tell me this. A favorite song off of, a favorite SWV song, any album.
Period. Okay, my favorite SWV song, period, it's an album cut. It was written and produced by Daryl Simmons, and it's You Are My Love. That is my favorite.
Daryl Simmons. He don't gain enough love. He's a brilliant songwriter.
He is brilliant. The way he works is just, I've never worked with anybody like that before. Mm. He made me sing the song top to bottom about 10 times back to back. So if you listen to the song, my voice is like raw. Again, he was like, yes. I'm like, good Lord. But I really love the end product. Yeah, I didn't get it, but I get it now.
Coco. Mm-hmm. So this is like her favorite song.
Yeah.
It's also Mariah's, as you mentioned.
Yeah, Mariah was playing it in the dressing room. And it blew me away that she knew that I wrote it. And then went to see her and was right there. Oh, I know. I knew you wrote that. I was like, whoa. I was like so honored that she knew that I wrote it. Because it wasn't a hit. Yeah. You know, but it was a good song.
But people then read the credits.
You're right. People that read the credits like me.
Mariah Carey reads some credits.
She does.
Yeah, she's a songwriter.
She schooled me on a few songs. Like, I just, Prince songs I never knew about. And even Mariah's favorite Faith song is Reasons.
Right? Really?
Yeah, that's her favorite. So,
really?
But
that's crazy.
So it doesn't surprise me that she loves You Are My Love. But that's Coco's favorite lead singer of SWV. What do you remember about working with SWV?
I went to New York. I wasn't used to working in New York. I don't know where I worked. Mm. I went up there to work with them. And once again, just great singers. Mm. You know, once I laid the pads of the backgrounds, Coco just let her go. Because that girl can sing. That's so unique. Such a unique sounding voice. Yeah. So I just let her go. And, you know, like she said, I worked her. They say I'm a slave driver. But
So you agree?
Oh, I agree. Totally. Yeah. I tell them, I'm going to work you. We're going to work.
That's how I am.
You know, and I, like, once again, I got that from Kenny. It's like, you don't quit. You got to make sure that you got it.
Yeah, man.
You know, and so, yeah, I worked her, and I knew it was there, and I don't remember it taking a long time at all, and I loved it. I love the way that the record sounds.
Yes.
Yeah. It's something about the way that record sounds. Yeah. Like, people say, what is your favorite songs? A lot of times, it's because the way they sound. And make me feel when it comes on. It's not that it's a hit or not a hit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's like a time period. I remember that.
Mm-hmm.
And there's something that's pristine about that record when it comes on. That just the way that the intro starts.
Yeah, I agree.
You know, like I said, Can We Talk is probably my favorite song because of the way it sounds.
100%.
Yeah.
It can't be duplicated.
It's just the way that it sounds and it's laid out. And, you know, Kenny did that, you know, because he's like a master at you know, laying it out and making the music have a personality. That's what I tell people. Probably 99.9% of our songs never start with the hook.
Mm-hmm.
Never. We would always save it.
Mm-hmm.
We would call that the payoff.
Mm-hmm.
But what we would do is make sure that you locked in on the melody in the beginning of it. So if you already are in, before you hear the first note, we know it's a wrap.
Phil's mind is blown over here.
See what I'm saying? And that was always the key. Let's make them fall in love with the melody before they hear the very first lyric. And if you get them there, you already know, I got you, because here it come. Here it come. And when that payoff, there you go.
That's how they're singing along with you. You already have them.
Right. So when you know the record, you already know the beginning because you already know where it's going to go and the lyric because the melody is singing.
Yeah.
Like we said, it's telling us what it's saying. Yeah. It's saying, not the other way around. Yeah, we got a title.
Yep.
So that was always, you know, Kenny's a master. He's a master at melody and making you fall in love with the melody first. The other part is easy, what I call connecting the dots.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I love to connect the dots.
Mm-hmm.
Once he lays the melody out and I see where it's going, I'm like, okay, I know where you're going.
Yeah.
And he knows I know where he's going.
Mm-hmm.
And then we get there, you know.
You mentioned sound just before that last part. And I remember Alvin Spites inviting me to your studio, Silent Sound.
Oh, wow.
Because I was working with a girl named Sean. Mm-hmm. And I just remember how good the NS10s and your Silent Sound sounded. Like, Alvin Spikes was like, yo, that's the best sounding, one of the best sounding rooms.
It is. And I can, not bragging, but I could say, yes, it was the best sounding studio in Atlanta when I owned it. And it still was maintained, but I'm saying,
yeah,
when I owned it, I mean, I went to Larrabee. Mm-hmm. I went to Encore. I went to Record Plant. I went to all my favorite studios in L.A. Mm-hmm. And we would go there and we would sneak. And TK would, I'd talk, maybe go outside and talk to my, TK would go in and take a tape measure. Okay, how's, as far as the speaker from here to here? How far are the speakers spread across? So I took all my favorite studios and combined it into Silent Sound.
Yeah.
And that's why it sounded so good. We had a box of pamphlets for a grand opening, and we never used them because once I opened the studio and let somebody use it, word of mouth went this. Yeah. I had to go to Doppler. Yeah. I couldn't even work in my own studio.
It sounded so good in there.
It was booked.
I'm telling you. The NS10s, I thought you had a sub running with them NS10s.
No, we never had a sub.
It's crazy.
It was the way that it was tuned and the speakers that were built. It was really more the design of the room. I think I took a combination of all those great studios. And, you don't know when you're going to build it how it's going to sound. And we got very lucky that it was a perfect, pristine. When you sat in that seat in the middle,
I've sat there.
I'm talking about it years later because it was crazy. Yeah.
Wow. And I for a long time I couldn't work in there because it was booked. We were making money,
Which is what you want.
It, which was what we wanted to pay for it. But I was at Doppler. I'm like, damn. Like, when can I get in?
right.
And I would only kick people out for Elton. Mm. Daryl, studio available. It is for when you want to go in. And I would give a good deal to that person who said, hey, man, I got an emergency. We'll give you a certain rate if you can let us come in. People were, they would oblige, and Elton would come in because he loved it. He would not work anywhere else, man.
Elton John would work nowhere else.
He wouldn't.
Silent Sound.
And he'd come in and have his cheese and flowers and wine and, and he'd work and he'd leave and I'd take all this stuff home. all the expensive wine. And you have all the assistants running around getting all these cheeses and expensive wines, and I would take all that stuff home.
So all these people you work with, right? I mean, just legend after legend after legend, both record and artists. Are there any people that you just wanted to work with but never were able to, or to this day that you still feel that way with?
I never got to work with Gladys Knight.
Mm. What?
And she's right in Atlanta, and I just because I love her voice, and I just never. That was that I would
that would have been a
loved.
Beautiful combination. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was one of those people that I never got to work with. I don't know why.
Yeah.
Just never
crossed paths.
Crossed paths. But she was one person that I always wanted to, that I felt could interpret something that I would write. Mm-hmm. But she was probably that person that I always wanted to work with that I never did get to.
The one that got away, Miss Knight.
Miss Knight.
Yeah, the one that got away. Yeah. I mean, she's still there, but it's what it is. But she was probably that artist that, because I had worked with Aretha and Patty and so many other people.
Yeah.
And I always wanted to kind of complete that
trifecta.
Yeah. Of working.
Yes, I feel you.
Because she's one of the great ones.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I always wanted to work with her. I wish I could have worked with Luther too. Mm. I felt like Luther would have been good together as a writer and just the way he sang and melodies, the way he actually wrote I did a Christmas album last year.
Yeah.
And one of the songs that I wrote.
So good, by the way.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. And one of the songs I wrote, I wrote it how I thought Luther would sing it. Mm-hmm. And so if you listen to it, you'll be able to pick it out. I'm not going to tell you, but you'll be able to pick it out which one it is. And I said, this is how Luther, if I could have had him, this is how Luther would have done it. So he's one of those artists I would have.
Well, I'm still here, Daryl. I can do it. I mean,
not many people, but probably those two that I wish I could have. It's not like you just have names. You want to work with somebody that you feel like you could have worked well together and created something.
Because the chemistry is everything.
Chemistry
and
the way that they do their thing, especially with Luther. Just he's a melody guy and a lyric guy. And, just the way he phrases things. I really wish I could have written something. Funny story is that I didn't know this till a few years ago. Kenny wrote a song, Every time I close my eyes, I thank the Lord that I got you. He told me he wrote that for Luther. Luther didn't like it.
What?
Yeah, Kenny won a Grammy.
And he
for
has
it.
Mariah Carey singing background on that record. Yeah.
Sheila, he's mm-hmm. on that record.
Yeah,
too.
She is. Yeah. And Mariah is on there.
So Luther didn't like it?
Yeah, he said Luther didn't like it. I never knew that. Kenny never shared that with me.
I can hear him.
I can too. Yeah. Can't you? Yeah, absolutely. He's like, I was like, why do you like that? Kenny goes, no, he didn't want to do it. So Kenny did it and won a Grammy for it. You know?
Wow.
Yeah, great. One of my favorite Kenny songs too. That's a really beautiful song.
But speaking of songs, I'm going to put my co-host on the spot right now.
Okay.
Favorite Daryl Simmons song. And again, can we talk? I think we all agree there, so I think we got to put that in a special.
I got to make sure I'm not missing anything. Hold on,
that's funny.
Favorite song. I'll kick it off. One of my favorites is actually from, and it morphs because sometimes it's Dru Hill, you know, the Never Make a Promise, but this one was from another girl group, SWV, Don't Be Mad at Me. Escape. Do You Want to?
Great song.
Yeah, that was good. Yeah, that was a
that's
good song.
Actually one of my, that's next to Can We Talk, probably like my favorite song. And I mean, Why I Love You So Much is like, depending on the day, but Do You Want to? I'm going to Escape. Do You Want to?
That was a good song. That was a really good song. They did a good job on that. That's a good record. That was a really good record. That was fun to do.
All four were there singing?
All four were there. Funny story about that was,
you know what? You're a troublemaker. He's a troublemaker.
What's funny is, Tiny showed up first. She showed up early. It ended up being Jermaine didn't like it because she wasn't supposed to sing. And so she got there early. So she goes, can I try it? I go,
I can't do this.
I guess.
Crazy.
You know, so she goes on the mic. And I thought she sounded really innocent. Never should have kissed you. Never made that call. I said, wow, her voice was small. And something was very believable about it that I ended up liking, and I didn't think I was going to like it. And the other girls showed up, and they were kind of like, you know, a little salty that she, because she doesn't normally sing lead, as you know. And then Jermaine called me, what's Tiny doing singing? Tiny don't sing? I go, well, she kind of did, but check it out. You know, there was something innocent about her, the way she sang it, because she didn't sing.
Right.
You know what I mean?
I love her voice. That's the funny part. I like Tiny's voice.
And
a lot.
So that's kind of like my Do You Want to Escape?
Never good at all.
Right. So there was something innocent and not really great about it, but
heartfelt.
Because she was trying so hard, because I had given her a shot at it and she normally wouldn't sing, she put a lot in it. And I was like, it's kind of feeling that a little
bit. But sometimes that's what the song needs.
Yeah, and so that was just kind of a fluke because, you know, usually Tasha or Candy would go back and forth. Yeah, they didn't like it at all. I remember they were salty when they got there.
They were like, what?
Yeah.
It was Tiny like on the first verse.
Yeah.
Unheard of.
Yeah, then Jermaine called me. I'm like, oh, I'm in trouble.
Uh-oh.
You know, but I mean, you know, it was his decision and he ended up going with it. I think he felt like I did once he heard the record being completed. And but that was a good record. Good group of girls.
One of my favorites. It's literally next.
Right, so, Do You Want to? Has been submitted.
Uh-huh. Good record.
I'm gonna have to go back to the Toni first album.
Please don't take mine.
Say mine.
Please don't take mine.
I'm sorry, guys. the music speaks to me. Another sad love song.
One of my favorite songs.
And the only reason I'm saying that is because I'm trying to be honest. Because there's like a Rolodex of songs in my head that I sing all the time. And I sing that, here come the strings, then somebody sing. Oh, like probably once
then
a week.
It starts killing me, babe.
It's brilliant.
Yeah. It's a good song.
It's brilliant. It is a great song. It's a great song.
It's brilliant.
It's not my favorite Toni song, but it's like.
Which is your favorite Toni song?
You Mean the World to Me.
That's my favorite Toni song. It's very close.
Which one? You Mean the World?
You Mean the World.
Mean the World to Me is my. And you know why? Because of the way it sounds.
Yeah.
It sounds amazing.
It's when it comes in.
Those pianos.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Right. Yeah.
Come on.
Yes, sir.
What about you,
Because of the way that it sounds.
Yeah. I was going to say another sad love song because that was one of the first singles that I got, and it had the instrumental on the other side. And that's literally that how I started to get into music production was through. Wow. I've said that before.
Wow, that's
funny.
It was
another Sad Love song, that instrumental.
But wasn't there more than one version of another Sad Love song? I feel like
that
maybe
I couldn't tell you.
Okay. I feel like there was an alternate.
No, no. Was Breathe Again for TLC?
No, never.
No?
Never was for TLC.
Okay.
Nope.
Perhaps I was wrong there with my
never was. It was Toni. Toni's songs were Toni's songs.
Yeah, period.
From my remember, period. If Anita didn't take them, then they were
Toni.
They were Toni because it was kind of close, and we were trying to emulate Anita to get her to do the songs. So it was unnatural.
When the songs blew up, did Anita come back around like my bad or
you'd never know? No, not to us.
Okay,
but she. I mean, Anita was doing okay, so it wasn't like. But, you know, you have to tend to think, maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe one of them.
Yeah.
One of the songs, you know.
Could have taken one of them. But
it, like I said, I am a believer that things happen the way that they are supposed to happen.
Yeah.
They happen for a reason. And that's, I move on. I don't dwell on it.
Mm.
You know, it's just like, okay, it happened the way it's supposed to happen. Didn't happen with me. Like the girls didn't happen with me.
Yeah.
They happen.
Well,
you know what I mean?
My second would have been, which is speaking of girl groups, is Baby, 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 TLC.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's the song that, speaking of feeling, as soon as that song starts, it just feels so damn good.
Yep. Mm-hmm. That was a session that T-Boz had a raspy throat, but we loved the way that it fit for yeah, at my time. Yeah,
I realized I could read because of that first TLC.
The lyrics were there.
And then I remember the address for LaFace, Piedmont Road, Northeast.
Like, a lot of people did. And we'd come out of the office, there would be kids down there. Can I take? Can I give it? It was like, okay, here you go. It was crazy. It was crazy.
Because being from Georgia, like that helped us realize that
the
music industry is actually a thing. It's possible for you to even work in the music industry.
And, because you didn't have to go to New York or L.A. People I drove from Philadelphia, so it was easy.
Yeah.
It was accessible to get to Atlanta and get to people. So we were literally at the office.
She drove.
I think when she first came.
Oh, when she moved, yeah.
When she moved or whatever she drove, I think.
From Philly to ATL.
I'm saying that to say it was a place that you could get to without having to spend thousands of dollars on a plane ticket to go to New York or L.A. So we were very accessible, and it worked out well for us because it was like a magnet where people just were standing outside. You go to your car, and people would be, can I give you a tape? Can I, you know, it was like, hey, you know, Chili was a background dancer for a group we had called Damian Dane.
I remember that.
And we were at rehearsal. Y'all want to hear me sing? I can sing. Y'all was like, you cute, but no. Go ahead, we're good.
We good.
And, you know, she ended up being put in the group because she was cute, and then she did have a voice.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, it happened the way it was supposed to happen. But it was just it was a crazy ride. I mean, literally, it was just a crazy,
man.
When I think of it, it was just a crazy ride of people that just came from the woodwork, and it was just there. It was, you know what I mean? It was just kind of there, you know?
And lightning in a bottle at that time.
Yeah, I remember.
Atlanta's one of the go-to cities for entertainment now, but do you sit back sometimes and say to yourself, like, we had a part in making Atlanta?
A little bit, but I don't take that credit that people try to say, oh, you guys did this and you started. No, we kind of helped it, by coming here and doing what we did. But Dallas was here and Jermaine was here. You know, people were already here. It's just people didn't know. I think we were the magnet that brought out a lot of people and a lot of those things, but it was already here.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't know it was here like that. We literally moved here because we heard that it was a great city to live in. It wasn't because we thought all this talent was here. It was like, hey, let's go. We didn't want to go home to Indiana or Cincinnati because we know all our friends would be jocking us for jobs and money. So they were like, okay, we've heard this place, Atlanta. It's great. Let's go there. It was like,
that's literally what brought us to Nashville. Was just,
you know.
Go to New York or L.A. or Atlanta again. So like, let's find the
next. Find a neutral place, and then it turned into what it turned into by the people that were kind of already there. Yeah, we helped to bring that out and discovered some people. But it was there. It just needed a platform. Like you said, there was no record company that you could get to. So we were a record company that people could
get right to.
Get right to. And they brought people by. And I remember Usher came out of the office that day and he was just this cool little guy. He was so cool. And he had been there. And like, I was this kid, Usher, I want y'all to, I want to sign him. I want to see what you and Kenny think. Like, okay. So what's up, man? What's up? Like 13 years old, had his little Tam on. And, you know, he's saying, I remember I said, man, he's got a good voice. I said, he's going to get better. And I said, what you think? I said, I think you should sign him. He's cool. I just like his whole, you know, he's got this infectious smile and personality, and he still has it. I saw him recently in Vegas. He's still that kid I remember, you know. And I just, things like that, Usher coming by and somebody bringing him by, or somebody bringing the Braxtons by. And just things that happen that you're going, dang, that happened?
That's what I'm saying. Like, these are legendary.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, when you think about it, how they started.
Paths crossing, you know what I'm saying?
No, as no names. You know, they started as no names, and then they end up being who they become. And
big names.
You were around.
Yeah.
You know, I was around when that was
happening,
and I saw it develop. Mm. You know, it's like you see the little duckling turn into the swan.
Yeah. We sound crazy!
Speaking of being around, Daryl, and tell me if this is true or false, because, you know, you find out things, and I have my sources. Being around, you had a stepson that is now a well-known gospel artist?
James Fortune.
What?
My kids, my two oldest kids, they have the same mom.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm James Fortune.
Okay.
That's my son's brother.
Yeah. See, not that many people knew that. I just want to make sure.
Surprise.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. James Fortune. And he was around, too, back then. You know, he'd come and visit and really young. And
wow.
Yeah. But yeah, he does really well. Does some really good records. Does some really good music. Yeah. Puts it together really well.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, and they're close, and DJ and him are really, really close.
Who do you love now? What artists excite you now? Does anyone give you that feeling?
Mm-mm.
Nobody?
I hear songs that I like,
but
nobody, like, gives me, like, oh, my, you know, they don't give me that just juice. Like, I like people. Mm-hmm. Like, I like The Weeknd. I like his music.
Mm-hmm.
I love the way Daniel Caesar sings.
Mm-hmm.
I like her. I like her songwriting,
mm-hmm.
you know, but I don't get a full, you know, but I think it's because we have too much.
Mm.
I think
I agree.
That social media has given us too much to pick from. And it's good.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of it is good, but there's, but it's too much.
Mm-hmm.
We don't get to kind of, we don't get to pick through the things that are special like we could years ago. Somebody would come up and like, where the hell did they come from?
Yeah,
You know, like when I first heard Mariah, is she black? Is she white? Is she?
Yeah, yeah,
we
yeah,
didn't
yeah.
know.
Yeah.
She was special, you know, and she was Mariah, only Mariah. And I think that's what social media has done. It's been good and it's been bad in that regard, where I think it's been saturated to where it's too much of it. It's too much to pick from. And a lot of it is good. Everybody's good. So you go, okay, yeah, she's good. Oh yeah, he's good. But you don't get a specialness because we're used to seeing so much. Frank Sinatra said, being in the music business was a very distinguished club. One day, somebody walked in and left the door open.
Ooh,
damn.
And that's always stayed with me. Because he's right, because artists were special. They were special. They didn't come along every day. They came along every blue moon, here comes this kid named, wow, where did he come from?
Mm-hmm.
Where did she come from?
Yeah.
But now, and like I said, I don't dismiss what's going on because it's good. It's just too much of it is the same. It's and it's very good.
Mm-hmm.
So nobody gives me, I think because I see too much of it that's really, really good. And I can't, there's no like separation.
Yeah.
So to say, I think that's why a lot of people.
Who in the hell left the door open?
Who left the damn door open?
Like, who is that person?
Who is that person?
We need to find the person. The door open.
Left the door open. Frank says somebody left the door.
Someone left the door open. We need to find that person.
But that's always stayed with me, and I thought it was just such a poignant thing to say because it was special, and it's still special.
I understand
in that sense, but you know, you know, to answer your question, I can't think of anything that just juices me where I go, oh my God, this guy, oh my God, this girl, she does this. And it's all very good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very good. Kids are talented out the yin yang.
They they're crazy.
You know, they're crazy what they're doing.
Online, you see nothing but talent. But
it's talent. Yeah. Exactly right.
But also artist development. I mean,
I think that's lacking.
What you were doing with the dolls, which became Destiny's Child. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's why that she can. Beyonce can come back and say, I remember what you said to this.
Mm-hmm.
Those lessons and the hard work and the discipline, and focusing until you get it right. That's also missing because technology makes it so fast.
Yeah, it's so instant. Good. Yeah, it's instant. You don't have to, like me and you talked about earlier, about the process of working. I love the process. I love working on it, grinding on it, coming back to it. Okay, is it good? It's almost there. Let me keep. Mm-hmm. I love that process.
Me too.
And then ultimately getting to, you know, what we get to say, yeah, it's there. It's good.
Yeah,
I think there's a lot that misses from the process because of technology. They make it so instant. You know, like I said, we're robbed of natural, with the human body. Mm. It's like that perfect imperfection.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Everything is perfect.
Yeah.
It sounds, and therefore it takes away from the natural sound of the voice to me.
Yes,
because it falls into, well, that sounds really good, but it also sounds like that record.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know what I mean? That person could have sang that record because it doesn't have a uniqueness to it, to me, a lot of it. At that part, I miss.
Yeah.
Of, like, I understand auto-tune. And one of the things I'm most proud of all the records that we talked about today and that you played in Mount Rushmore and Favorite, it didn't exist.
Auto-tune didn't exist.
Didn't exist. And people say, well, how did you? I said, come back tomorrow. That was the auto tune. That was auto tune. See you tomorrow.
We'll try again.
Really? Toni was like, for real? I said, yeah. I said, see you tomorrow. Then she come back in the next day. I go, this was yesterday. She go, ooh. I said, here you are today. Okay. You like it. I love it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, that was the auto tune.
Yeah.
I'll see you tomorrow. Mm-hmm. It ain't happening today. You don't sound good. Yeah, you don't sound. I'm telling you. I know it's hard for you to believe. Right. But
you need to go take a nap and come back.
Yeah. Or my thing was come back. It was the day. It wasn't going to happen that day. It was sort of like a player being on or off, like sports. Yeah. He ain't on today.
That's true.
That's how I looked at it. And if they were off in the first couple of, you know, an hour or so, I'm sitting there, it ain't going to be on. I ain't going to sit here and waste their voice and waste their time. Like, I'll get it tomorrow.
Yeah.
For real? Let me try it one more time. You can try it, but I ain't going to use it. And I would. I'm like, okay. And that was my thing.
I bet,
like,
you ruffled a lot of feathers that way.
Absolutely, I did.
Yeah.
But I was doing my job. My job is to make the best record that I can make. Mm-hmm. And you put me in control, and I'm going to make sure that you sound the best that you can sound. So let me do my job. I ain't out on stage trying to dance and whatever. So this is my domain. Let me do what I do.
You do what I do.
Yep. And trust me. And they, and at the end of the day, everybody was always happy. Like Coco, he worked me.
Mm-hmm.
But it's her favorite song.
Exactly.
I worked her.
Exactly.
Yeah, I sure did. Yeah. And that was just my way. Everybody doesn't work the same. You guys don't work
superstars
the same.
Still need to be coached.
So, Daryl, I'm not going to ask you your favorite song. I'm not going to ask you your favorite song, but I am going to ask you your favorite session. Is there a favorite session that you can recall as like, man, that was just my favorite for whatever reason, but just your favorite session?
Favorite session? I would probably say it was probably the BoyzIIMen session because it was under the gun. There was no time to come back tomorrow.
Right.
There wasn't a you can get it tomorrow, Wanye. It was in the moment and everything that kind of played out naturally. When I think back on it, at the time, I wouldn't have said that. But even after talking with you today, that was really when I hear the record and hear how it came out.
Yeah,
it's really a special moment.
Mm-hmm.
Not my favorite song, but one of my favorite songs, but the session of it and the process of that.
The memory of
it, of him standing there and giving his all and having a towel around his throat.
That's iconic.
You know, and you know, you would think the session would be like a funny, fun session. That's TLC. Those just are clowns. There's too many of those sessions to make because those girls are just straight fools. But me remembering something that was, like you said, a great memory and then the result of it would probably be that session, even though it was quick, it wasn't a long session by any stretch. It was, but so much went into it in such a short time. You know what I mean?
But, I mean,
iconic.
I know. Listen, this book that you're writing, I cannot wait to read whenever it happens, however it happens.
Yeah.
Because as you were telling the stories from the beginning of our conversation, I was picturing.
Yeah.
There's a lot of stories.
The replay of all these things.
And we need the audio book, too, because the impressions are just...
That's what I'm saying.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Kenny's doing it. He's starting to work on a documentary of his career.
Okay.
He just started looking for a director. So I said, I'll let that happen, and I'll fill in the blanks. Mm-hmm. You know, L.A. wrote a book. Kenny will do a documentary of his life, and he'll cover a lot of things because, you know, same story. So I'll wait and give him that, and then I'll fill in the blanks. But I have a concept of it, and the concept of it is, I think, that I would just, like you talked, I would just talk about some of those things that people didn't know that occurred behind some of the songs or just some of the sessions. Yeah. Not the typical, you know, things that happen, but some special things that people, you know, like Michael Jackson driving his car.
Driving a Suburban. And crashing.
That's just funny to me. You know what I mean? That's like crazy that you would never thought that that happened.
I just keep thinking about the oxtail stew.
You know, oxtail stew.
I want some right now.
Right.
You know, so I'll kind of try to come from a different angle.
I think it's needed.
Yeah, it is. And I think it's fun. And I think, like me, I'm interested in those kind of unknown behind the scenes things that I did. Oh, I didn't know that that happened. I didn't know he did that. I'm intrigued by that. And I think people will be intrigued
by
those things of, well, I didn't know Kenny wanted to keep End of the Road and tried to record it and blah, blah, blah.
Now, my mind was blown several times.
Several. Yes.
So those, several that's my concept of it. And there'll be chapters of, you know, I have it laid out in my head, like, you know, Indianapolis, Indiana, growing up, you know, next chapter will be Kenny Edmonds, meeting Kenny and how, like I told you, some of those stories. And there's a lot more. You know, chapter will be Michael Jackson. We tell the Michael Jackson session. And the last chapter will be, of course, End of the Road.
I'm tuned.
That's the very last chapter.
I'm tuned in.
I'm all in.
I want to know.
Yeah. So that's, I have the layout of it.
Yeah.
Of how I want it to go. And then I'll just do stories and see where Kenny, what he hits on and what he doesn't hit on.
And give all the juicy details that he doesn't give.
Absolutely. You
know, exactly.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. Because we both have, he's got a great memory. Mine is really good, but his is even, no, remember we did. I'm like, yeah, Kenny, yeah, you were right. he's impeccable. He'll call me sometime. I want to ask, do you remember when we, I'm like, He's intrigued by the past and
The details.
How we got here and what we were doing and, you know, how did we survive? And I mean, and you know, when you think about it, it really is a great story.
It's a great story.
You know, L.A.'s book is mostly about, you know, his growing up in LaFace, but there were 6 years living in Los Angeles that people don't know. Like I said, you know, people coming by the apartment and, you know, we singing the songs all these people come. People don't know that that occurred. It was a struggling time. You know what I'm saying? I was walking to the studio. I was riding the bus. I got a job at Budget Rent-A-Car at Santa Monica and Wilshire. When I still pass there, I go, that was the low for me in my life because I had to get a job and I wasn't going back home. I was not going back home. That's crazy. Never forget it. Kenny dropped me off one day because he was married at the time and his wife wanted their privacy. So I had to leave, asked me to leave respectfully. And then I said, man, and he dropped me off one day. He says, if you can figure out how to stay out here, he said, something's getting ready to happen. And I said, I'm not going home, Kenny. Ain't nothing to go home to, you know, get a job in the factory with my dad, which that ain't going to happen. But he said, if you can figure it out. And I figured it out. And I got me a job. And I walked. And like to this day, if I pass Budget Rent-A-Car at Santa Monica and Wilshire, it lets me know where I started.
Where you started.
Where I started. And I started there washing cars. It was exotic Budget Rent-A-Car. So people would come and rent Porsche. For Roux, I learned about cars. I'm a car guy now. Mike Tyson, Robin Givens came in. Oprah came in. I'd show them, hey, this is how you start the car. Don't slam the hood. Push it. Here's the start button. I delivered cars to Beverly Hills Hotel. And that's how I became a car guy.
That's how I became a Ferrari club, though.
Yeah. That's how I became a car guy because they taught me about those cars, how to start, whatever. So I was like, man, what? But I never thought I'd own one. Like, you know, I wasn't stupid. I never owned a car like this.
Right.
You know, so... Things like that that people didn't know.
Yeah, people didn't know that stuff.
That I would tell my kids, like, dude, you couldn't have done what I did. You know, I was out there, no relatives, you know, riding the bus, walking, get to Silver Lake. We're working with Karen. I'll get there. Get on the bus. Kenny would get me when he could, you know, drop me when he could. But I was going to be there, and I was there. Mm. You know what I mean? So stuff like that people didn't know was going on before LaFace. That was going on all before LaFace. LaFace was, we were rolling when we came to Atlanta in 89. Mm. We were already rolling production-wise.
Yeah.
You know
what
I mean? We were making money. We had artists, you know, people came to work. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the 6 years that we lived in
LA.
Budget rental car years.
Yeah, 83 to 89 when we went to Los Angeles. We went out there in 83. Stayed in an apartment together, and it was surviving, not, you know, trying to make it happen. It was rough. No cell phone, no social media. It was pretty, you know, I mean, stop at a payphone, have some quarters. Let me see if I can call Kenny. You know,
I can call Kenny from the payphone.
Yeah, from the payphone. Yeah. You know? And so I had to survive. So I said, well, I got to get a job because I wasn't making, there was no money.
Yeah.
You know? And I got a call one day and he says, you got a check. And I go, okay, you got a check for In the Mood for $14,000. I'm going, yeah, right. Me and LA got a check for $25,000. I'm like, yeah, right. We're going to come pick you up. So they come pick me up. And it was a place right there in Studio City, the deli place. But anyway, they picked me up. And Kenny, I go, so what's the catch? No, there's no catch. He said, that's just the beginning of royalty. He said, that's the beginning. He said, you're going to have more checks. They're going to be bigger. I'm going, so I get to keep all this money. He goes, yeah. And he goes, me and LA got 25 grand a piece, you know, because Rocksteady was really hot and I had, In the Mood was on the album. And I'm like, okay, this is some bullshit. I never had like probably $500 at one time. And once I felt that and understood what it, because Kenny understood it early because he had co-written a song called Slow Jam with Bo Watson for Midnight Star. So he kind of already knew the royalty thing and how it worked. So he was on top of the publishing and, you know, he taught me a lot of stuff about that. And that's why he said, no, it's just the beginning checks. It's going to get bigger. And he was right. And it got bigger. And, you know, I got my own apartment. Next thing I know, I got a car. And it just...
Off to the races.
Off to the races. And next thing I know, we're moving. Like, we're moving? Yeah, we're out of here. You know? So there's a beginning.
Yeah.
And you know, people, and it needs to be told because people don't know. You know, they don't know that there was a beginning, there was a struggle, and nothing happens overnight. I don't believe in overnight success. That just don't happen.
It don't happen.
You know, because you guys, everybody's got a story. You got a story? You guys got a story?
Everyone got a story.
You know, but we have a story.
I know that bus struggle all too well.
There you go. Yeah, man. It was,
no, it's real talk.
Yeah, it's like I said, people don't know before. They just think you popped up. And
and it's all love.
You had cars, you had this. It's like, dude.
And even then, it's the hard work to maintain it.
You know? Yeah, dude, I got a new car when I was 32 years old. That's when I got my first new car. 32 years old. Went to Beverly Hills Mercedes. I was scared. I was terrified driving it. I was like, I'm not supposed to be in this car. Everybody's honking at me. I had a phone in it. And, you know, Ellen Kenny was laughing at me because they already had cars because they had, course, made a little money first because they were producing.
Yeah.
And I was terrified I had this car. I'm not supposed to be in this car. It was weird.
Yeah.
You know, and years later I heard.
You got used to it. I got used to it.
Oh, yeah. But I heard Don Henley say, and I write sayings down in my phone. He said, success can be just as disconcerting as failure. Mm. Where most people say, how come this never happens for me? How come that didn't? He goes, why did this happen to me? And Kenny would ask me that. He goes, why do you think this happened for us? And I go, it's a good question. I say, well, we've been very honest with music. We've done music for the love of music, not for anything else. Mm. You know, your money is great. We made a lot of money. But I said, I think we were always honest with our music. And we never took it for granted. We never took advantage of people. Even to this day, Kenny goes, oh, don't you know who I am? We never did that with people. It's like we would wait in line, like other people would wait in line. And so I thought that was my answer because I felt like we were and have always been honest about what we did. Mm. You know, we never took advantage of it, never took it for granted. Like, hey, got to keep working, stay down here, stay humble. No, we ain't made it. Don't ever say that. Just keep it in perspective. You know what I'm saying? Don't go too high.
Yeah.
Don't go too low. Just keep it.
That's the same thing. You know? We had Jimmy Terry Lewis on a year or two ago now, and they were like, we just want to stay cool in the middle.
Yeah. Stay cool in the middle.
We don't want to be too high and too low. That gets too traumatic. Just coast and focus on what you're focusing on. And I mean, that's everyone who's great has the same.
Yeah. Under promise, over deliver. And that was, I've always kept that. Just keep it, even when things were whatever, we never gloated, you know. Never that, I told you, man, this is going to blow up. Wait till you hear. Well, that wasn't, we said, nope, let the music speak for itself. Mm-hmm. Don't say anything. No, you know, we would predict within the three of us, you know, but we would never do that outside of
publicly,
us.
Publicly,
publicly, it was like, what do you think? How you feel about it? I was like, man, In the Row, that's big. you could have never told me it was that big. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Toni's first album. I remember Ellie said, what do you think it's going to sell? I said, 1.2. 2 million. I said, you crazy. I said, 1.2. So nine, 10 million. You know?
You crazy. 1.2.
Yeah, I was like, 1.2 all day. You don't sell no double, 2 million.
You ain't going double platinum.
Ain't going double platinum. And voila, that's the power of music.
Phil, it went double platinum.
Yeah.
It did.
A few times.
A few times. A few times.
So, like I said, I think, and when Don Henley said that, it fit me so well because a lot of people always say, how come this never happened? This never happens for me. But then what about when things do happen? Mm-hmm. Do you question why it happened for you?
Yeah.
You know, and not others. Because Kenny and I were the least talented in Indianapolis. Mm-hmm. I can tell you, we were low men on the totem pole when I was on the bottom. Mm-hmm. And Kenny was not a singer. Kenny was a guitar player in the bands that we grew up in. There were other guys that sang. Mm-hmm. They were incredible musicians. They knew theory. Mm-hmm. They knew. Mm-hmm. We were just these kids from the suburbs who wanted to write songs. But we were low. Like I said, I was on the bottom of that totem pole.
That's crazy.
I was on the bottom, and he was above me because we were.
But that honesty for the music and that humility served you well. It serves you well to this day.
Yeah. I've always kept it that way. He's kept it that way. And, you know, Quincy Jones says, be humble with your talent and gracious with your success. Mm. Be humble with your talent. Don't brag about it. Yeah. It's always people more talented.
Yeah.
You know, but be gracious with your success. You don't have to, you know, be all whatever, flamboyant, whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, like I live a great life. People amaze the life that I live, but I don't brag about it. I don't say this or that. It's my life,
yeah.
You know, and it's a pretty good life.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Because I think I've kept things, like you said, like Jimmy and Terry.
Cool, right here.
Keep it cool. Just keep it right there. You know what I'm saying?
I love it.
So
love it.
I don't.
Wisdom.
We sound crazy.
The Esther Roll
Award.
So that person talking right there at the end, Esther Roll.
Yeah, good times.
From Good Times.
Yeah, absolutely.
So in what do you know what year it was, Tamone, since you introduced us?
75.
Yeah. 1975, Esther Roll did a gospel album called The Garden of My Mind.
Never knew it.
Exactly.
Wow.
Neither did we. Tamone knew, though. Tamone knew.
Tamone knows everything.
So, yeah, he does. So he's playing it for us, and we're like talking about how we had no clue this thing existed, which led us to this conversation about how many of our icons don't get properly celebrated for their work. There are many that do, but all mm-hmm. the ones that don't get the love that they deserve
mm-hmm.
That we should be celebrating. So we created an award here called the Esther Roll Black Excellence Award.
I like it.
Every episode, no matter who's sitting in this magical seat,
mm-hmm.
Nominate somebody, and mm-hmm. then we literally with a show of hands vote, and then we kind of just like to honor on the podcast someone who may not be known as well or loved the way we think they should be loved.
Mm.
It's our way of highlighting some people that should be highlighted.
Gotcha.
So it's about that time, Phil.
About that time. Who you got, Phil?
Who are you nominating for the Irby this week?
To me, it just feels appropriate.
It feels appropriate.
I'm sitting mm-hmm. here with the man who's done so much over the course of decades.
Yes. Yeah.
I had a thought coming in, but hearing it, because I knew your discography.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But hearing just reminded me, man, you got to give people their flowers.
Yeah. Immediately.
Immediately celebrate them here and now. My nomination for the Esther Roll Black Excellence Award this week is the one and only. Our guest this week, Daryl Simmons.
Absolutely.
I agree.
Appreciate that.
Yeah.
I agree.
Appreciate that. I'm like, yeah.
Do I get a second?
No. Second, third, fourth.
Okay, yeah, got emotional.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, normally we go around the table and we vote, but it's not even a question.
It's
a
no-brainer.
When you're telling those stories, I also know your discography, I think, better than most people out who listen to music. Mm-hmm. But it's not just the songs. To hear how you've been a part of weaving together what is now black music history, but American history, yeah. American music and American history, mm-hmm. is incredible.
Yeah, man. Mm.
And it's inspiring to know that a musician who has this much integrity for not just in music, but just in life, mm-hmm. Is successful. Because sometimes the louder story is that doing the wrong things or the loud things, mm-hmm. or the bad things get you. But I'm talking about you are dedicated to this thing all the way through.
Oh, absolutely. From the moment I started.
And you hear it in the music. That's why it lasts and it feels so good still. Mm-hmm. And you got to get your flowers. Anytime we see you, we're giving you your flowers.
Oh, I appreciate that. I had a dear friend say to me some years ago, she said, you know, you're that guy that if something were to happen to you, people would go, oh, yeah, him. Mm-hmm. We should do something for him. He said, you're that guy. I said, okay. Pretty much.
I'll take that.
Yeah. You know, it wasn't a slight. No. Yeah. It was just, that's my position of, you know, who I am, what I've been. Mm. And I'm comfortable with that. Mm. Like I said, I've always been a behind the scenes guy. And as you know, our reward is, like you said, pulling up next to somebody in the car and they're singing.
Yeah. You hear them singing a song, they don't even
Miley
know.
Miley Cyrus at the top of their lung, you like, yeah. Wow. Yep. That's like I said, that's the payoff. So everything else is great. You know, I appreciate it, but I've been comfortable with it. And like I said, I've lived vicariously through Kenny.
Yeah.
As me being an artist. So things that happened for me. Like when he got a star on the Walk of Fame, that's my star.
right.
You know, I was there.
Yeah.
You know what
yeah.
I mean? And he knows that. And anything great that's happening to him, I'm the first one he'll call.
And I love that.
Guess what? Yeah, I got a call from Bruno. Headed to Bruno's house. I'm like, what? Yeah, he finally called.
Y'all still talk like that.
That's what it is. We don't talk about music. He'll call and say, how's your mom doing? You know, how's your kids doing? What are you up to? Mm. Oh, I'm on my bike, whatever. We don't talk music. If something happens for him, he'll call me and tell me literally every day. You know, he's 3 hours behind. He'll be taking his daughter to school or dropping her off. And if something good's going on, he'll let me know. And he knows I'm happy for him.
Mm-hmm. You know, I love that.
Well, call him and let him know that you got an Irby.
Let him know you got nothing on me.
You ain't got nothing on me. What?
I've lived vicariously through him. And, you know, I'm proud of him. And, you know, I'm proud to have been there since being 15 years old and see him grow to that point and do those great things that he's done.
Yeah.
One of my most poignant times with him was when he was doing Exhale. And he told me he wanted to meet with me. And at the time, he and L.A. were kind of at odds and going through their whatever. And he goes, hey, I wanted to tell you that I'm doing this album for Clive, Waiting to Exhale soundtrack. And I'm going, okay, cool. Like, let's go.
What are we doing, right?
We're doing it. You know, I said, but I wanted to tell you that I'm not doing it with L.A. He said, I want to see if I can, you know, do it without him. And I was like, oh, yeah, you can do it without him. He goes, but I can't do it with you either. And I was just like, I mean, I'm trying not to go there with this dude in front of him. Mm-hmm. And he goes, because if I don't do it with L.A., they'll say it happened because of you and what you do. He said, for once, I want to see what I can do on my own. I want to see if I can do it.
Mm.
And even though it hurt, I respected him for telling me, you know. And I said, well, I said, you never need me. I said, you're always good. Mm. He goes, no. He's like, I always feel like I need you in the room. And I go, okay, that's cool. But I said, you'll be fine. And I'm still trying not to, you know, I'm fighting it back, man. I'm fighting it back. And I finally went there. And, you know, he told me a lot about what I meant to him. And, you know, and I, to this day, I tell people, it's like, he never needs me. You know, he's Batman. I'm Robin. Mm-hmm. You know, you got a little situation? Okay. Need me to help you out? Okay. You know, he'll call me. You know, but if he don't need me, then he won't call me. And we don't have any ill will.
Right.
He'll tell me what he's working on. Like, okay, that's cool. Yeah, I'm working on this with Bruno and I'm working on, you know, girls' night out. Like, okay, cool. How's it going? Oh, it's going good. I'm working with all these girls. And I'm like, okay, cool. But I don't feel any kind of way.
Yeah.
Because I've always, that was always my role. When he needed me, he would call me. And so when I look back on the times that he did call me, I'm very blessed that he called me for some of the things that, you know, you guys have heard today.
Yeah.
Like, can we talk or whatever? When he called me, he said, hey, I got this idea. I want you to help me put it together. I was like, okay.
Yeah.
You know, but that was a very kind of a, but it also, I was able to spread my wings
because of that
at that point, you know, and he was honest about it. I respected it. It hurt, but I grew so much from it. Mm-hmm. And of course he went on to do what he did with XL, which was amazing. And then years later, I came back around to do Christmas album. And I said, well, and I used kind of the same approach on a different level, not even comparing, but said, I've never produced a whole album by myself. Yeah. And so the Christmas album was my sort of ending thing to say, let me see if I can do this, do the songs, do the production, pull all the people together, put it together, you know, on a different level, of course.
But it, but.
And so I'm very proud of that work and I'm proud of that album. It's not a big, I did it for myself. It wasn't for a record company. It wasn't to, oh, this gonna blow up. No, 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 it's not that. It was for me to kind of close out my circle of my career to say, I wonder if I could do that, like we talked about. Yeah, I wonder if I could do that. And I did it in my way, and I'm proud of it. You know what I mean? It, it's something that I'm really proud of that I did, because I never thought, as a producer, sitting back on the couch watching them, you know, surely I can't do that. They're just, you know, that'll never happen for me. So
you did
it, a lot. Yeah, a lot of things that went into that that kind of sums up my career. And like you said, a lot of the things that I went through working at Budget Rent a Car, whatever it was, to get to a point of a body of work that I'm very happy with that I did.
I love that.
You know what I mean? Yeah. For myself. It's totally for myself.
And I love it.
You know, nobody critiquing, nobody saying this ain't good. This is whatever.
Just what you want to do.
It's what I want to do. I started out approaching a record company. I got, you know. And so it's something that I'm really proud of. And it's something that, you know, we can release every year.
Yeah.
And people can listen
every
to
year.
It. Because Christmas music doesn't get old.
Yeah, it doesn't get old at all.
But yeah, a lot of little poignant stories like that that people don't know.
Well,
you know what I mean?
We actually had only met, what was that, last year or the year before?
A couple years ago.
At Berkeley.
At Berkeley, yeah.
Don't hate. I was actually getting awarded, an alumni achievement award, if you will.
Shout out to Berkeley.
You see what I'm saying?
Yep.
But I was like, we saw that you were coming, and I was geeked. And literally since then, I mean, we haven't, there's life happens and you're in different cities.
Oh, yeah,
but
absolutely.
We DM each other, and it's been really, it's been an honor for me to be able to even just have that relationship with you, because sometimes our worlds are so isolated.
Yeah, absolutely.
That you're in your bubble, I'm over in this bubble, or you're in the studio, you're traveling here, but just to know that there's people out there rooting for you or just looking out.
I appreciate that. I appreciate it a lot. Like I said, I've been comfortable with that, but when people do things like you do, I'm receptive to it and I appreciate it.
Yeah.
And it's just been, like I said, I've done more in my career life that I ever dreamed as a kid that I would ever do. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Like working with Aretha Franklin's, like my mother played those records on Saturday and she's cleaning up.
Right.
And now I'm here working with this person. It's like, how did I get here from Indianapolis?
Right.
Yeah. I've had many of those moments.
Yeah. Where you just go,
How did I get here?
How did I get here?
I'm having that moment right now.
It's like it's currently happening as
we speak. So it's a lot of, you know, a lot, and I'm much older than you guys, but I've had a career. When I look back on it, I don't think of it until I get in a setting like this, and maybe you ask a question. I'm like, damn, that was a good question. Then you jog my memory of something that happened, you know, because I just kind of go on with my life and say, okay, like an athlete, okay, I had a good career and did some pretty good things and did this, did that.
But it never stops, though, when you're a creative.
You know, no, it doesn't. I don't do it for anyone. Anymore. I do it for myself. You know, sit at the piano or whatever, but I'm not trying to be on no project, whatever. I'm good. Like I said, I am totally good. People go, what do? I go, ride my bike. You know, go for a run.
Chill.
Chill. Go to a movie.
Yeah, I feel you.
You know,
enjoy life, man. Yes. Enjoy it.
And I talked to Kenny. Kenny admires that because he said, well, I ain't got nothing else to do. I said, no, you don't. Because I asked him, I said, how long are you going to keep doing this? He goes, I don't know. He goes, what else am I going to do? I go, I don't know. He said, you don't have hobbies. He's not a car guy. He's not a sports guy.
Yeah.
He's done music since the day I met that dude, man. Yeah. Just still going at it.
Still going at it.
Like I said, like he never wrote a hit in his life.
I love that.
Like he's never written a hit record in his life. So, you know, I admire that. I love him. He's been a great brother. And all those, we've been through so much, through marriages, childbirths, divorces, funerals, successes. We've been through, you name it, the struggle, struggle together. You know what I mean? We were always, you know, roommates on the road and all that stuff. And, you know, sat there and ate tuna out of the can. And, you know.
Crazy, man.
Just when you think about it.
From zero to 100.
Zero to 100. Yeah. It's like, could have never imagined it. It's like, it's really, I can't even say it enough to you that it's from where we came from.
Yeah.
It's just not even possible to me to think about.
The fact that it happened, it's possible.
And that's why he would say, why did this happen? Why do you think this happened for us? Because
why did this happen?
Well, we're glad it did. Seriously, you know? Grateful because you created a soundtrack to our lives.
Yes.
You said American music, history, American, literally. This is soundtrack to my life for sure. Mm-hmm. But thank you. This has been
an amazing, incredible
conversation. Incredible.
I appreciate it, man.
Anytime you're in Nashville, you know where to find us.
I know where to find you. Right. Might take a minute,
but you know where to find us.
Y'all hidden up in here, but
we're hidden on purpose.
I know where you are now,
But you know where we are.
Yeah.
We Sound Crazy is literally set up to be able to tell these and share these kind of stories.
Yeah.
So
thank
you for your time.
That's perfect.
Make sure you follow us on all platforms at We Sound Crazy and WeSoundCrazy.com, anywhere podcasts are streamed or viewed.
We got to shout out the people who support us.
Yeah.
The whole city of Nashville got our back. Visit Music City literally is our partner here with We Sound Crazy. So shout out to them. And if you're in Nashville, you know where to find us and there's lots of cool things. This is Music City. Come on. And, before we leave, we always turn to our guest, right?
We do.
All right, so this is a tradition now.
Okay.
We've had a long, deep conversation and a lot of music. But based off of this conversation, we allow our guests to choose the song that we go out with. What encapsulates this conversation? What song has taken us out of this episode of We Sound Crazy, according to the one and only Daryl Simmons?
It's definitely an Earth, Wind, and Fire song.
We're in a good place.
So, and there's so many, of course, that I love. But when I think of going out song, I'd say it would probably be an up-tempo song or an energy song. Mm. One of my favorite songs of theirs that wasn't a hit, well, it was kind of a hit, is a song they had called Can't Let Go.
Can't Let Go by Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Y'all don't know it. See? Y'all don't
even
know
it. I got to hear it.
Yeah. Can't Let Go.
I'm thinking Can't Hide Love.
Yeah, I'm thinking Can't Hide.
Can't Let Go. Can't Let Go is up-tempo.
So not only are we going out with this song, but he's putting us on the music as we go out.
Right.
So
I'm putting you on to this. And you've heard it, but you don't know it. I know Earth, Wind, and Fire, so that's
mine.
All right. And that's my guy, so.
I mean, very few people get to say that they know Earth, Wind, and Fire personally.
No, I don't know them personally. I mean,
you just know the music.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm in tune.
All right,
they're our friends, though. They're friends of the show.
Of course, they've been on the show as well. But this is one I haven't heard before. Put us on. So what is the song we're going out on right now?
Can't Let Go.
Earth, Wind, and Fire. This has been a great episode.
Did you find it?
Amazing episode. Thank you, Daryl Simmons.
Thank you.
Thank you
so much. Until next time, y'all. We Sound Crazy. Be out of here.
Peace.